He started painting in obscurity 120 years ago, but now it seems Henri Rousseau has finally made it onto art history's A-list. Although his exotic scenes have long been popular, as posters they've graced a million children's bedrooms, in his own lifetime, the critics took a machete to his painted jungles. He was stigmatized as a naive, untrained amateur who could only paint part-time after finishing his dreary day job. Henri Rousseau was a taxman, and in 1890 he painted a slightly glancing depiction of the kind of work that he did. But if you wanted to meet the man himself, and the truth is that you probably didn't, you'd have to walk this way, to his toll booth on the Paris city limits. It was Rousseau's job to enforce a deeply unpopular local tax on any goods entering the city, wine, cheese, bread. He was the man who searched your bag, who asked you if you had anything to declare. It was a boring and repetitious life. And as his antidote to it, Rousseau retreated into a world of his own making. You say I just can't help myself. I really, really wish I could be somewhere else than here.
I can't think of many other examples in life, in art, in history, where an individual has been so fantastically determined to push themselves forward in an area where they have no background, no track record, no skill and no support.
But despite that, Rousseau took himself very seriously, as this self-portrait shows.
He depicts himself as a great academic painter, a painter of stature, with a berry and a palette, in a sort of wonderful location with the Eiffel Tower. It's a fantastic vision of ambition and hope.
But posterity still struggles to place Rousseau. The graphic simplicity and vibrant colour of his large-scale fantasies had a big influence on modern art in its experimental heyday. But although many an avant-gardist copied his seemingly childlike directness, Rousseau himself never quite shook off the stigma of the Sunday painter. And even now, while Tate Modern's giving him the full treatment, in the pretty French town of Laval, where he was born, his work's just a sideshow in a minor museum of naive art.
Here in the museum at Laval, they've subjected Rousseau to a form of municipal mummification, with this extremely artificial reconstruction of his studio, complete with memorabilia and various of his possessions, like paintbrushes and books, carefully arranged like so many saints' relics. The paradox is that what the museum doesn't have much of is Rousseau's own art. This picture on the easel is just a reproduction. And to make matters worse, what it does have loads of is naive art, art by children, art by amateurs. That's what this shrine has made Rousseau the patron saint of, when he spent his whole life proclaiming that the one thing he wasn't was a naive artist.
Rousseau's art was inspired above all by the fascinating experiences of French colonial explorers, their stories and photographs of wild animals and other exotica. Some of Rousseau's personal archive is preserved at Laval.
This is an album. It was a very popular album at the end of the 19th century. Rousseau so used to look at this book for his inspiration for jungles.
Oh, right, yes, of course, because he never travelled.
He
told people that he travelled, didn't he?
To Mexico, he used to say he travelled to Mexico, but it was untrue.
All the travelling was going on in here.
Yes, in his mind.
Yeah.
Because it was probably the first popular book about wild animals.
So this is sort of his crib book.
Yes, and you have jaguars to birds yeah. that he used to reproduce, yes.
As a hard-up, petty bourgeois taxman, Rousseau's contact with jungle animals was limited to the Paris Zoo and the stuffed menagerie now in store at the Museum of Natural History at the Jardin des Plantes.
Rousseau based a number of his pictures on the stuffed animals kept in the Jardin des Plantes, and this piece was obviously the inspiration for The Hungry Lion Throws Itself on the Antelope, a classic Rousseau jungle scene of 1905.
Likewise, the exotic plants Rousseau saw while walking in the adjacent gardens and hothouses were the basis for his lush tropical foliage.
I think Rousseau had this astonishing ability to take those animals from their cages and, you know, repopulate the dense forest vision that he'd seen on the other side of the Jardin des Plantes. And this is this collaging, this taking different images from different places and creating something entirely new that's so unique to Rousseau.
Collage interested the Parisian avant-garde, and they were the first to notice Rousseau. The young Pablo Picasso collected his work. But even if he saw something in it, Picasso couldn't help mocking the self-taught outsider.
The writer Gertrude Stein tells the story of how Picasso organised a great banquet in Rousseau's honour. It sounds like a pretty chaotic occasion. Everybody got absolutely slaughtered. Someone fell into Rousseau's birthday cake, and the evening ended with Rousseau himself standing on a table performing his favourite song. Aïe, 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 j'ai mal aux dents. Oh, 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 I've got toothache. But years later, Picasso turned round and said, "We weren't laughing with him, you know. We were laughing at him," making the whole tribute sound as if it had just been an elaborate and rather cruel practical joke.
Ever since his death in 1910, the case against Rousseau has rested on the idea that he was just a village idiot of art, who painted in a primitive style because that's all he could do. Tate Modern's show could punch a big hole in that theory, all because it contains this little picture, a sophisticated piece of urban realism painted in Paris right at the start of his career. It might not look like much, but this homage to French Impressionism shows that Rousseau was perfectly capable of painting the real world accurately, with perspective and atmosphere. And what that proves is that the childlike style of his later work wasn't forced on him by deficiency. It was a style he chose for a simple reason: to give his work the dreamlike clarity that's the continuing source of its power.
One of my favourite pictures by Rousseau is The Rugby Players, Le Rugby, a wonderfully absurd depiction of a group of petit bourgeois with their handlebar moustaches who've been set free into nature. I think Picasso was wrong to patronise Rousseau, and I think Rousseau's work still speaks so strongly to so many people because we can identify still with its spirit of escapism. He was the ordinary guy, the man who said no to the 9-to-5, to the boring daily grind of work in the customs office, and he set his imagination free.